test because I have to make sure there's audio because there's a bug in OBS that sometimes doesn't start the audio. So I'm continuing to talk to make sure we have audio. There we go. We have audio. I don't know why it's coming out of my speakers and not my good speakers, but that's who cares. All right. So, casting on Dementia Radio now, and recording in 3, 2, 1. I always forget to turn my screen off. Let me do that again.
Recorded live on DementiaRadio.org, it's the Funny Music Podcast, brought to you by TheFump.com, where you can download new free comedy songs twice a week. Now, here's your hosts, Devo Spice and the great Luke Ski.
Hey, Devo Spice.
Hey, Luke Ski.
We have Il Neige on the show. That is me.
He's not on video because we forgot to tell him it's on video now, and he's not presentable at the moment. So, hi.
I've not put on my face, nor my ears, nor my skin. I am pure red blood and meat.
he is a pile of bones that is babysitting a dog, and that sounds dangerous.
Yep.
So, welcome to episode 573 of the Funny Music Podcast for June 10th, 2021. There goes the naked waffle iron again. So, yeah. I'm tired. I'm getting sick. Let's just get this underway.
Let's get caught up with what Devo and Luke have been up to since last week. Or else Devo, if Luke failed and didn't show up.
Hey, what?
Oh, he's right.
So, Luke, what you been up to?
I have been literally driving nonstop since the last time you saw me last week. No. I went to the Midwest and I got to see my friends and my family. Yay! So, I won't go through, like, all the details of all the things, but started off by spending a couple of days at Carrie and Josh and Alexandre's house, and that was super cool. Carrie and I got out to see the movie Cruella, which was the first time I've been to see a movie at a movie theater since the pandemic started. The last one, I believe, was Pixar's Onward, which I really loved a lot. Cruella is really good. It's, you know, that whole phenomenon of they put all the best stuff in the trailer?
Yeah.
This is the opposite of that. This is they hid all of the best stuff so that it's not in the trailer. And I just kind of, like, once again, all the knee-jerk people being, you know, who, like, have either heard about things or just seen little bits of things are like, oh, this is another stupid movie. It's like, I'm just so sick of that attitude. But because basically, looking at all of the kind of Disney of the past, you know, handful of years, the live-action remakes and stuff that they've been doing,
mm-hmm.
This one's pretty much like, you know, I'd say it's within the top five, if not possibly the best one. It was just really good. Emma Stone is great in it, and Kate Blanchett is really great in it, and just, yeah, anyway.
Yeah, my father saw it. He said it was really good.
Your dad?
Yeah.
Yeah, I dug it. What else? We took Alexandre to, it used to be called Level 257. It went through two name changes the last time we were there.
Oh, jeez.
After that, after Level 257, because nobody figured out that was a Pac-Man reference, I guess, they changed their name to Pac-Man Entertainment, which made more sense.
Okay.
And there's still a sign out front that says Pac-Man Entertainment, and it looks cool. But now they changed it again, apparently, and the name of the place, I think, is now Enterium, like the word enter and then I-U-M, Enterium or something.
Hmm.
But, and it's still the same thing, like bowling alleys and bitchy games and food, so it's like, I don't get what the highfalutin name is all about. It's like, Level 257 was closer to a name that meant something
yeah.
that people would figure out.
Are you tired of places that only have exits? Does your home only have ways to leave? Come on down to the Enterium. We got all the entrances you could possibly want. Big doors, small doors,
benches.
Double doors.
Yeah, my guess is they probably got a cease and desist for using Pac-Man in their store name.
Yeah, that would have been my guess too.
Well, I would assume that they probably had it licensed from, you know, Namco or whatever. Maybe they just decided they didn't want to pay the licensing fee anymore.
Maybe, yeah. So,
But yeah, so that was fun. After that, I went to Madison for a night and hung out with Stephanie. We went down to State Street, and I saw a bunch of the artwork, you know, the graffiti and mural art that's been done up on State Street, you know, following all of the protests of, you know, about a year ago, and things there. It's like things are starting to open up there, but also there's, you know, on State Street, a lot of it was, you know, businesses that were locally owned, you know, not chain businesses, so a lot of them have gone out of business. So it's just kind of sad to see the street that was once thriving with all these unique individual businesses, and like, oh, look, Taco Bell survived.
So, surprise. You know,
there's still a handful of them left that, you know, from the old school days, so I'm hoping that'll come back. And unfortunately, did not run into Art Paul Schlosser on a whatever day that was in the morning. Then I went to Lake Geneva, and I hung out with my mom and my sister, got to dip out to Gurnee and see my brother JT and his wife and their son Max, and got to hang out with him and play with Transformers in the backyard. And then we played chess, and four-year-old Max handed my ass to me at chess. He's so nice. Smart. It's like I can, more now than ever, I can see my brother JT and Max, because JT, like, we got our first video game system when he was about 3, and so he would play it with me, and he just got really competitive and really smart about stuff like that at a really early age. So hanging out with Max and seeing him, like, know all these rules and strategies for chess, it's just like, yep, you're your dad's son, all right. So, but he's cute and fun and everything. And then in the evening, last night, two nights ago, it was my brother Michael's 40th birthday. So, we had a Zoom family, birthday party, because Michael and Anu are up in the Twin Cities still, and we even had Anu's parents and brother come in on Zoom from India, so it was a unique experience with everybody. So I just love the fact that all four of the Sinkowski siblings are now in their 40s, which is weird. So, but yeah, so that was all good, and I managed to do some amount of going through. Something I've been wanting to do in small amounts every time I visit is start going through the stuff that I have in storage out there at my sister's place, my mom's place, and just start trying to pare it down, like, you know, one category at a time. So I went through, I've been carrying around like a good dozen or so big plastic bins and a handful of cardboard boxes full of VHS tapes. You know, like half of them being like store-bought movies and stuff, and the other half being things I taped off of, you know, TV or cable or, you know, comedy specials or whatever. Or just tons of cartoons, or just, you know, back before I knew that CD box sets were going to be a thing, or not CD, DVD box sets were going to be a thing, and or that streaming platforms where you could literally have the entire run of a series,
right,
that you could watch in perfect, pristine digital viewness, you know, over the internet for free at any time, you know, so if I had all these boxes of, like, you know, 24, season 3, tape 1, 24, season 3, tape 2, you know, so I basically was like, I want to, like, that's going to be step one, is going through all that, and, you know, so I, by the time I got done there, like, you know, like imagine, like, your average, you know, kind of garbage can or recycling can that you take out to the corner, like the big tall ones with the wheels and the, you know, fold, you know, lifted plugs. It's like, we had one of those completely full of videotapes, and another one partially full, and then two really big cardboard boxes full of the movie tapes, like the store-bought ones, that I left there for them to donate to people, because basically they were all movies that are super common that you could get anywhere streaming, no problem.
Yeah.
and the ones I held on to was anything that I thought was rare that probably wasn't available, you know, everywhere. And then also just a bunch of other things that were like, I just basically looked through each label real quick to see if it had like some obscure comedy special that I assumed wouldn't be available anywhere. So I basically pared it down to about altogether 4 to 5 boxes tops. I know one of the boxes was at least half full of Muppet related things because I got the Time Life Muppet set of VHSs. It wasn't all of them, it was just like 40 of the episodes. But I know the ones on Disney Plus, they cut out some of the songs and stuff because of music reasons. So I want to kind of compare and contrast and make sure that there aren't any episodes on there that have stuff been, like, you know, deleted or whatever. So yeah, I also found an important piece of, well, I guess you could say it's, you know, Luke's key history that I wanted to bring back with me, and I managed to find it, like, just before. I was looking into my sister's basement for 5 hours, like, doing the videotape stuff, but also trying to find this thing, and I couldn't find it. Then I went back to my mom's house, and I went to her attic, and I found it within, like, 2 minutes. So, like, I should have started there. But yeah, so it was an all-around, you know, great trip. I'm so happy to have seen everyone in my family and all my friends and everything. But I am thoroughly exhausted. I did get 7 hours of sleep last night, but I still feel like so fatigued. I know when I get home from working this shift, I'm just going to collapse on the bed and, you know, probably fall asleep again until I have to get up and work again tomorrow, which will make Hubert happy because he gets to just cuddle up by me and be a cuddly boy. And special thanks to TV's Kyle for taking care of the guy while I was gone. He would send me pictures of him being a cute, cuddly boy. So that's been my week. What has your been week like for time stuff?
Well, as I mentioned last week, I've been working on the sound booth under my basement stairs and been having trouble getting acquiring the drywall I need because I want the special soundproof drywall. And We left off last week with me coming up with deciding to go with my wife's plan of going to the store, buying the drywall, cutting it down in the parking lot, putting it in my car and driving it home. And I was going to do that, but I kind of really didn't want to because if I, you know, I would have to like take very careful measurements here and then drive an hour to the place that sells the drywall, cut it in the parking lot, and if I screw it up, you know, then I have to buy more. You know, likely I won't know I screwed it up until I got home, put it up, and it didn't fit. And so Friday, on one last-ditch effort, I did a Google search for that drywall again to see if there was any place else around me that carried it. And, like, on page 4 of the search results, I found a blog entry that said, "Top 5 soundproof drywalls for your recording studio." And I was like, there's more than one? So I read this blog entry, and the first one, they said, this is the best one. It's used in professional recording studios, but it's expensive. And I was like, let's see if Lowe's carries it. So I went over to Lowe's and searched, and not only do they carry it, they will deliver it. So I was like, score! So I ordered it on Friday, and it said, okay, you know, they don't deliver over the weekend, so it'll arrive Monday. Fine. And there was a little note that said, you know, due to delays and COVID and blah, blah, you know, shipping may be delayed. So, you know, delivery times aren't guaranteed. But it said mine was going to arrive on Monday. So Monday morning, I signed up for the text alert. So I got an email and a text that said, your item is out for delivery and it should arrive between 1 p.m. and 3 p.m. I was like, great. So I made sure I was home. 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, nothing doesn't show up. You know, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, never comes. So I'm like, okay, it must have been delayed. It'll probably come tomorrow. No big deal. So Tuesday morning, I get a text and an email that says, good news, your item's been delivered. And I was like, the hell it has? What? I don't know what, it's not here. I looked on the Lowe's.com website and I pulled up the order and it said, you know, there's been some kind of delay and my order was still processing. And then it went to the tracking thing and it said it was had been delivered. And I'm like, okay, clearly there's a disconnect here. And I really think that their tracking system isn't actually hooked up to a back end of any kind. And it's just kind of there for show. So I gave him another day. And then yesterday I called them, and it took me almost a half an hour to get somebody on the phone. And I said, so what's going on with the drywall? It says it's been delivered, but your website says it hasn't been processed yet. What's going on? And she looked and she says, I don't know. Let me get somebody in delivery. So she put me, you know, transferred me over there. He looked at the you know, his computer system, and he's like, yeah, I don't know what happened here. Let me put you on with so-and-so. So I'm like, another hold. And this guy picks up the phone. He's like, yeah, I don't know what happened to your order. Nobody puts any notes in the system, but we'll get it set up, and you can have it, you know, we'll get you set up for tomorrow. And I was like, I'm going to be out, you know, that was today, Thursday. I was like, how about Friday? So in theory, my drywall will be arriving tomorrow. So we'll see what happens. Stay tuned next week for more.
begs the philosophical question. If somebody delivers your drywall and no one is there to pick it up, does it make a sound, especially if it's soundproof?
If it's soundproof, yes. If they deliver it and no one is there, is it really delivered? So, yeah.
The guy's, like, standing right next to your house with the thing. I'm out!
You broke
up. This stuff works too good!
Yeah, so I was home all day, and not only that, we have a camera on the front porch, so, you know, I would have known if something came. So the reason I couldn't get it today was because I had to go out to take my youngest two kids for their second COVID shot, so we did that today. So they are all nice and vaccinated now. And real quick, cartoon talk, if you're up for it real quick. I watched all of season four of Castlevania, and I've decided I want a book of Castlevania background art, because holy shit, the background art on Castlevania is astounding. And it's like it's on screen for like less than half a second. And if you pause it, it's like it looks like this beautifully rendered watercolor painting. I don't know if they do it digitally or not, but it's beautiful. And it's on screen for a half a second, and then they cut to another scene for a half a second, and they cut to something else, and then there's vampires and stuff. But the background art is just beautiful. So I want a book of Castlevania artwork. I was kind of disappointed with season four because there wasn't the story just wasn't
amazing.
Told very well. What was that? What'd you say, Luke?
Oh yeah, I think my reception's kind of going in and out a little, but yeah, you should maybe try to contact the studio, or at least figure out, you know, which one makes it so that you can find out if they have any intentions to release a book like that.
Yeah, I absolutely will, because it's remarkable stuff. So season four was cool. The story didn't really come together as well as previous seasons. The first episode and the second to last episode were excellent, and then stuff in the middle was just kind of a whole lot of nothing. It was beautifully rendered, but not much happened. The last episode was just kind of a denouement. The climax was episode 9, which is weird, but whatever. It was fine. Hmm. The other thing I watched was I watched all of MODOK. And have you seen more than... I know you and Kyle watched the first episode. Have you seen more than the first episode?
Yeah, I'm... How many episodes are there total?
I think there's 10.
Okay, I know I've seen at least, like, the first four.
Okay.
But yeah, what I've seen, I've really liked a lot. So, yeah.
I liked it, but I didn't love it. You know what I mean? It was like, I kept waiting for it to get better and grab me and really make me laugh. But it was like, I liked it enough to keep watching it. You know, I never stopped enjoying it, but I kept waiting for it to, like, really get its hooks into me and really make me want to binge the entire series. I never really did. There was one joke that really made me laugh hard. And I don't know if you've gotten to it yet. It's the one with the rabbi. And that's all I'm going to say.
Okay, I don't think I've gotten to that one yet.
Okay, Garrett, do you know what I'm talking about?
No, I haven't started. I just like hearing, with no context, the one about the rabbi.
The one with the rabbi, yeah. The rabbi is the one who tells the joke, and it's glorious. And it's like, they tell the joke, and they just kind of, they both, like, look at the camera for a beat while they wait, and then they move on. and I laughed really hard at that joke. So you'll know it when you hear it.
On Rick and Morty season 4, like, usually their titles are like these ridiculous plays on existing movie titles or whatever, with the words, you know, Rick and Morty, like, thrown into it. So, but in the back end of season 4 has an episode that's simply titled "The Vat of Acid." The Vat of Acid episode, because it's an episode that starts with a major thing that happens that involves a vat of acid. So I think they just decided, you know what, we're just going to call this one the Vat of Acid episode. That's what everyone's going to call it casually anyway.
Yeah, might as well.
Yeah.
And the other thing,
rewinding slightly. Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead.
Oh, check in Amazon. There is a upcoming Castlevania animated series art book, scheduled for August, up for pre-order now.
Nice, excellent. I will definitely pre-order that, because holy shit, dude! Seriously, look at this artwork. It's amazing. The other thing I watched was season 2 of Love, Death, and Robots, which was fantastic.
Oh, yes. I was surprised that it was a shorter season.
It was a shorter season, and there were shorter episodes, too. There were a couple that were only, like, 8 or 9 minutes long or something.
Man, I got to the end, and I'm like, wait, that's it?
Yeah. But, yeah, that was really good, and some of that CGI was astounding. It was, like, Star Wars level.
And there was only a couple that were intended to be funny, but... man, they were really funny.
Yeah, the Roomba episode. I mean, I don't know what else to call it, but yeah, that was great.
yeah, that was so good.
All right, so Garrett, what have you been up to?
Like you mentioned earlier, my parents are out of town, so I'm watching their 6-month-old retriever puppy who, For lack of a better term, they have descended, and he has he's gotten very wily as a result of that. So that's fun. He's way less sweet at the moment. But his name is Kylo, so I guess it's appropriate for him to have erratic mood swings.
That makes sense. Yes.
Yeah. And yeah, apart from that, not much else. My partner Erica just moved in, so now we're roomies and get to roommates who smooch each other. That's pretty neat. You know, the way
he wouldn't smooch me for some reason. I don't know why.
I was waiting. I was trying to think of something, because for those of you listening at home, Erica is Luke's ex-roommate. No, there was no relationship other than roommate, but I was trying to think of something to say.
Actually, I do know why, because if you take a picture of me and then put next to a picture of Garrett, and then you'd be like, oh yeah, Garrett, all the way. So yeah, that's why.
No comment.
But no, they're the best, they're awesome, I'm so happy they are together, they have an adorable place, and they're making it zero!
And now we just get to combine our giant collections of plush dolls and Funko Pops at last, every couple's dream.
Yes. So when you guys get married, you're going to have Funko Pops at the top of the wedding cake?
Obviously.
Yes, there you go.
I was like, I wonder if anybody's like, who am I kidding? Of course they've done that.
Yeah, I was just thinking, I'm sure somebody's done that.
It's like you get a couple who didn't want to pay for customs, so like we will be represented by Mary Poppins as portrayed by Emily Blunt and Freddie Mercury in the yellow jumpsuit outfit. That's us.
Nice. All right, so you posted a song.
Did I?
Yeah,
I did.
Give us a quick intro and we'll give it a listen.
All right, well, at the end of... was it? Yeah, right at the end of April, Nintendo put out a new Pokemon Snap, which is a 20 years later follow-up to the Nintendo 64 classic Pokemon Snap, where you go through the Pokemon world taking pictures instead of capturing them or forcing them into dogfights with each other. And after binging that game for about a week, somehow photographed by Nickelback also re-entered my brain. And the two just came together, and I don't know if it's harmony, but it's something.
All right, here is Look at This Poke Snap by Il Neige.
Look at this Poke Snap. A Bulbasaur taking a nap. For a sec I thought he was dead, till I threw an apple at his head. Professor called me one day, gave me a camera and a tank, said I needed to document an island full of fire-breathing pets. So many new Pokemon I haven't played since 151. Don't think I've ever heard of Buffalant. And when the hell did Todd get so hot? I guess I'll go and explore. Too bad this lens can't zoom in more. I can barely see from that far. Oh, how the hell was that one for stars? Oh, come on, just get closer. Every creature here can murder me with one blow. How was any of this sanctioned for a 10-year-old? And now survival is my mantra. Don't die, don't die. Around every corner there's another surprise. Like a snacking looking at me with its bedroom eyes. This leery ape, I can't escape it. God, why? God, why? Now I'm starting to see that everything revolves around me. I thought it sounded a bit absurd until I made friends with this bird. Hey, look, it's Meganium. Let's get some pics for my Instagram. I'll bust out of this creative rut by putting sunglasses on his butt. Professor said it'd be neat if Magikarp and Pidgeot could meet. I'd be happy to grant his wish. Hey, wait, did I just murder that fish? Oh, God, why? I'm a monster. I'm the rest of wild animals with fresh breath.
Very nice.
Listening to that made my throat sore all over again.
So, for those of us who are not in the loop, please explain what Pokemon Snap is.
So, Pokemon Snap is a rail shooter. Like, gameplay-wise, it's like a rail shooter, but instead of shooting at the things you see, you're just taking pictures of them. And the scoring system is based on, you know, what pose is the Pokemon doing? How is it in the center of frame? Is this a rare behavior that you had to manipulate the game to, like, get just right? And, like, yeah, the original game came out in 1999, I think, for the Nintendo 64. Big hit. You could, like, go to Blockbuster even and print out your photos as little stickers. And people have been wanting another game like it for, I guess, decades at this point, and was finally in 2020 when they delivered.
Was it a Nintendo 64 game, or was it a Game Boy game?
64.
Huh. Because I don't remember it for the 64. Then again, I was never into Pokemon, so I didn't really pay much attention to it.
Yeah, 64 had a lot of just nonsense not third party, but just nonsense Pokemon titles. I don't know if you remember Hey You Pikachu either.
That one I do remember, peripheral. Yeah. Yeah, I do remember that one. I remember it existing. I never played it.
Yeah, it's not a functional... It is not a functional game.
Oh, so it's like Superman 64.
Pretty much, but with, I don't know, you get to yell. Like, when you yell, the game does hear you. So it's got that over Superman 64.
Cool, so... You released a video on TikTok, and it kind of sort of went viral. How's it going since?
I think it's... but let's find out. Last I looked, it was past 500K hits, which is...
Nice.
541,000 at this point, which is literally like the most engagement I think anything I've ever made has gotten, except for one very embarrassing picture of me dressed as Cloud from Final Fantasy that I took when I was in high school. But yeah, and it's wild just because I'd had TikTok for a while and I just kind of did some very basic, you know, okay, here's this meme, here's this offhand observation about a show. And I just threw this up there. I just threw a shortened version of the song up there, hoping like, okay, and maybe this will get some extra traffic to the YouTube channel. It has eclipsed like the YouTube traffic. Like, you still have to go to my channel to get the full song, but again, like, none of my videos on my channel have anything close to the views on this one TikTok.
So the version on TikTok was an edited shortened version.
Yeah, you get a verse and like half a chorus on there because also they have their 1 minute. They're 1 minute time limit, so I had to squeak it in under that.
Yeah, I was wondering what you did because I know some people will like break the song up into like three parts or something like that. And I didn't know if you did that or not.
Yeah, I just did. I did a part one, and then I meant to do a part two, and then I forgot.
Well, it seems to be working, so I wouldn't bother.
Yeah.
Put it at the bottom for the whole thing. See my YouTube page.
Pretty much.
What were you going to say, Luke?
Yeah, it's just impossible to predict what will or won't catch on TikTok. Yeah, because I can say that about any of the, you know, platforms, but it just seems weird because, like, for example, I took all of the, like my medley, When You Wish Upon a Death Star, which is combining Disney and Star Wars, and I, you know, put out each little individual parody as its own video, just for the sake of having it all, and I listed them, you know, kind of part one, part two, etc., just so that everyone knew that it was part of a series. So the only one of those that got any traction was, I think it's the fourth part of the song, which is like a four-line spoof of the Davy Crockett theme about Obi-Wan Kenobi, you know, and like that got significantly like a huge, like thousands upon thousands of views, and all the rest of the parts of that medley got nothing, and I don't understand why, you know. I tried doing it for Grease Wars 2, and nothing took off from there, and even some of them only got, like, you know, like 26 views. It's like, what am I doing wrong? You know, so I'm glad that the algorithm got smiled upon Garrett so that something with quality and effort and, you know, comedy and goodness, you know, actually got noticed and everything. So, yeah.
I know you mentioned that you had the idea that your Obi-Wan parody kind of picked up steam because, like, the show is sort of trending now because it's like in production, but what's so funny about that is it's only the fact that it's an Obi-Wan thing, because the Zoomers don't remember the Davy Crockett theme. I barely remember the Davy Crockett theme.
I mean, like, the Gen Xers remember it because, you know, our parents were the Boomers, so it was around, it's like they had it around enough in their pop culture bubble that we witnessed. It's like, oh, okay, that's what that thing is.
Yeah, I think it was in syndication when we were growing up, because I know I've seen it.
I don't know if I've ever seen any actual Davy Crockett movie or TV show, but I know the song because it was like we'd have to sing it at school or in 4-H or whatever, you know. So
yeah, same. I couldn't tell you the plot of a single episode. I just that song will live in my head forever, though.
I know that he killed him a bar. I know that. So,
like you do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Garrett, tell him about the other thing that happened.
So, the week the video goes up, Luke is kind enough to post a link to it on the Dr. DeBeno Facebook page. And just like, hey, request, put this up there. It gets some extra clicks there. Like, oh, how nice of Luke. What a nice thing to do. That evening, I get a message on Twitter. It's like, hello, I'd like to interview you about the song. I'm like, oh, okay, some guy's podcast. Turns out it's a guy who makes segments for CNN's affiliate stations.
Nice.
So I end up getting interviewed about the song, and it didn't go up on like CNN, the channel, but up on their website is me explaining myself and why I've unleashed this upon the world.
That's
now.
Awesome.
And it's all thanks to the finest, the goodest, the bestest, the great Luke Ski.
Have you heard anything from Nintendo or their lawyers?
Fortunately, no.
Because I know Nintendo is real picky about people using their IP, and I don't even know if that extends to gameplay footage, because I know they've shut down a lot of streamers from what I've heard.
Yeah, with this, I think... I've never had issue. The only time I've had them come after me for gameplay footage is because of I was streaming like a game that was very cutscene heavy. It was a Zelda game, and every instance of, you know, like the bots can't detect your version of Link running across a grassy field versus like the official one. They can absolutely detect the cutscene where right. the monster takes the child,
yeah,
or whatever. But as far as I don't think I have anything to worry about. I'm mostly surprised that I didn't get claimed by the Nickelback bots.
There's still time.
Yeah, well, just believe the Nickelback bots.
Yeah, I mean, all the Nickelback songs sound alike, so, I mean, they just claim all of the songs.
I'm trying to think of a Chad Crowbot. Do we have 30 minutes to workshop this?
Sure, yes. Chad T. Crowbot, is that what you're going for? The Mystery Science Theater?
Oh, just Chad Kroger, but is robot. I'm trying to think, like, there's got to be something there.
Love, sex, and crowbots. I don't know.
There we go. My favorite film company is Chad Crowbot. Chad Robot. And scene. Notes, everybody.
Yes, there we go. Cool. All right, so do you have anything you'd like to plug?
Just my YouTube channel, which has the worst name ever. It's Il Neige, ILNEIGE. In addition to the Nickelback thing, I'm songwriting my way through the whole Pokédex. Working on the next song now, which is currently planned to be Charizard. So if you want to join me in celebrating... The most underrated, the most maligned, a Pokemon who never gets any attention from Nintendo. What gives? Finally, Charizard is going to have his day in the spotlight at long, long last. You know, I'm happy to do that for the poor, maligned minority of Charizard fans who just never get, you know, their day in the sun.
Awesome. Looking forward to that.
For sure.
All right, so we're gonna do some news and another song and stuff. So thank you for joining us, dude. And congratulations on the success of the song.
Yeah, thank you. And I promise, if you have me on again, I'll be sure to have video next time.
Sure. And then we fully expect the dog to eat your face on the video, so be prepared for that.
He'll be there, and he'll be such a good boy.
All right, thanks, dude. We'll catch you later.
Have a good night.
This is the FuMP.
Only people with too much time on their hands do jury duty. Only people who got no significant plans do jury duty. I got places to go and people to see, not stuck with some upright citizenry. It might do it for you, but it doesn't for me, not jury duty.
That's the Funny Music Project at thefump.com. THEFUMP.com.
Without guilt or shame. Don't hate the player.
Hate the video game.
Don't want to take my pants. Don't want to put on a shirt. I don't want to eat dinner. I just want dessert.
Blown from the portal in my dryer where all the socks go. There's a hole in space in the back of my dryer. Travels to some place with a piece of my attire. And the situation has grown pretty dire. I'm about to run out of socks.
Foy.
Time for funny music news. Something, something, something.
In the news, we have some news about FuMPCast.
FuMPCast?
Because FuMPCast is happening now. So let me put the FuMPCast graphic. All right, we have not one, but two new sponsors since we last talked. First, Escape from Vault Disney. Hosted by Tony Goldmark, Escape from Vault Disney is a weekly podcast all about the movies, TV shows, and short films available on Disney+, chosen completely at random and dissected for your amusement. Tony is planning to have me on the show as a guest at some point in the future. Escape from Vault Disney is available on your favorite podcast directory, or go to escapefromvaultdisney.libsyn.com. So thank you very much, Tony. And our other new sponsor, Dave and Ethan's 2,000-inch Weird Al podcast. This podcast is an exciting weekly podcast revolving around Weird Al Yankovic and his fandom through fun interviews and engaging discussions. Hosted by two of Weird Al's biggest fans, you'll catch interviews ranging from everyone in Weird Al's band to those who have performed or recorded with Weird Al, collaborators, and those involved with Weird Al's non-musical projects, celebrity Weird Al fans, and even Weird Al's dentist? Yep, that's right. For episodes and more information, go to WeirdAlPodcast.com. So thank you very much, Dave and Ethan. And I haven't put these up on the website yet, but they will be up soon. We have our three final performing artists available to announce. They have all been confirmed and are raring to go. First up, Steve Goody will be joining us once again at FumpFest. Second up is Carla Ulbrich. Yeah, da 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 da. And third, last but not least, the great Luke Ski.
Say what? Say what? Say what?
Tun 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 tun.
Yay! We couldn't get anybody better. Yeah.
No, I had people who listen to the show will know I was really trying really hard to book Ookla the Mock for FumpFest, and I was trying to give them as much time as possible to get ready and get Adam in performing shape, and it's not going to happen. So I was like, all right, I got to give up the slot. So here we have Luke.
Yeah, I won't mention any acts, you know, specifically, but you know. Life is life, especially this past year and a half. Things are weird. It's hard to get, you know, everyone is having a tough time getting to places.
Yes.
So, you know, but, you know, nonetheless, we're going to do the best we can to give an awesome, fun weekend of the comedy music for all of the fans who can come out to northern Chicago.
Oh, it's going to be awesome. Yeah, it's not like I settled for anybody. I mean, Steve, Carla, and Luke are all going to do fantastic sets. I'm 100% confident about that. So it's not like I guess my cousin will perform, you know.
I mean, in-person Thump Fest, I didn't have a scheduled slot, but I was the designated alternate if somebody backed out, and then Raymond and Scum ended up backing out. So I had to plan for a concert literally that day. Like, well, okay, time to make playlist.
Yeah.
And it went fine. So this time it's like I basically told Devo at some point recently, he was getting things figured out. I'm like, okay, so if X number of people back out and there's a slot left, I'd kind of like to have a scheduled concert. And that's what happened. Yay. I mean.
And you know what I just realized? With you having an official slot, we don't have a backup for this year. So,
does Ian have a slot?
Yes, he does. So, I guess I'm the backup for this year.
Or Chris could be, maybe.
Or Chris, yes. We did that in 2015. Chris and I split the slot when Mikey Mason didn't show. So, we could do that again. Okay, I have one other guest to announce. Not a performing guest, just a visiting guest. Although she is going to be performing at least one song at some point during the weekend. Ladies and gentlemen, longtime co-host on the Dr. Demento show, Sulu, will be joining us. She was part of the gang back in the days, the early days of the Dr. Demento show, when he had a whole bunch of people in the studio with him. And she also had a hit comedy song herself with a song called Trapped in a Closet with You. So we're looking very much to getting Sulu out to FumpFest. I'm trying to get a couple of the other old co-hosts out as well. I just haven't confirmed any of them yet.
Sulu appeared on, like, you know, because they were, it's like, you know, kind of like how the FUMP generally, we put out songs and like, oh, here's a new song by Devo Spice, and then like four other members of the FUMP are on the song, like just uncredited doing whatever. You know, that's the kind of the way it was back then. So I know Sulu's been like some Barnes and Barnes songs, and you know, she's she was all over the place. But yeah, she's such a wonderful person, and I'm very happy she's going to make it out. And I'm, you know, I hope that some of the other old school crew can you know, figure out a way to come out as well. Because
you know what's funny is I've been contacting most of the old crew through Jeff Morris because he has all the contacts. And
yeah,
so, but I contacted Sulu directly via Facebook because we're friends. And so she has kind of taken it upon herself to contact all the other people. And she's like, oh, I'm trying to get this person. I'm trying to get this person. I'm like, great. Let's good. Let's do this.
Isn't it always nice when it's somebody else takes it upon themselves to poke people with sticks?
Yes. It's so nice when other people are excited about the thing too. All right, I have a new shipment of CDs from Needle Juice Records. Problem Attic by Nuclear Bubble Wrap is now available in the store at thefump.com. Available on CD for $11.99. This features Intelligent Design, Curiosity Killed the Mars Rover, Vagina Regulator, Zombie Elvis, and more. He only sent me the CDs this time, so no vinyl or anything. All right, well, that's all the news I got for this week. You got anything?
I don't think so.
Alrighty. We have tour dates, and holy shit, people are performing again. Alright. On Sundays, coming up through the rest of this month, I believe, is Escape from Secret Lab featuring Dr. Pinkerton. On Thursdays, online, Steve Goody. Tomorrow night, online, Carla Ulbrich. Carla's show is going to become a monthly show, but she is performing tomorrow night, and then I think that's the only time she's performing online for June. All right, and then tomorrow night, the 11th, in Santa Cruz, California, Phil Johnson and Roadside Attraction. Also on the 11th, online, Mikey Mason. The 14th through the 27th, online, Steve Goody. On the 16th, in Redding, California, Phil Johnson and Roadside Attraction. On the 18th, in Muncie, Indiana, Mikey Mason. On the 19th, in San Francisco, California, Phil Johnson and Roadside Attraction. And on the 21st, in Ewing, New Jersey, Larry Tritell. I may have to go to that. All right.
It would be neat if at some point while I was driving here, I just came up and, like, there was Phil Johnson on the side of the road. And it's like, oh, look, it's literally a Roadside Attraction.
That would be great. You got to find him. All right. Second song of the week is by Joe J. Thomas. Here is The Like Ship, followed by a brief interview with Joe.
Love Boat prequel, The Like Ship, pilot episode, Reel 1.
Life, your balls may turn blue. So hot, but not into you. And like, you just want to score. We all know it's not her, it's you. The like ship, everyone thinks that you're just no fun. It's friendship, just stick a fork in you, 'cause you're done. There's no course to adventure, you won't get a second chance. And like, no need to feel sore, it's a wave goodbye door. It's life, you will be bored with life.
Told you. I'm here with Joe J. Thomas.
Hello.
Hi, Joe. And Skype did an update recently where when you start recording, it says this meeting is being recorded, which is fine. I get it. So, you know, you want everyone to know it's being recorded. However, they have the absolute worst quality voiceover for that little this thing is being recorded sound. It's like, yeah.
It's a vague female approximation of the old movie phone voice.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds like it might be a synthesized voice, which, yeah. Okay. But, like, you know, Siri is substantially better than that. And it's, like, it's not even, like, you know, a good quality sample. It sounds like it's, like, 8 kilohertz. You're like,
yeah.
You're like, you get 128K MP3 and reduce it to 8. That's what it sounds like.
Yeah. They have a Laserdisc version that's much better.
I'm sure. but we didn't come here to talk about Zoom. We came here to talk about the Like Ship. So tell us about the Like Ship.
Yeah, I gave into my baser instincts and went the full on parody karaoke route. It's like a song that I've been singing forever, and I'm like, oh, okay, I'm just gonna make a parody out of this, and yeah, and then of course the we've heard it already, right? And this this recording, okay. Yep. So the hello dog,
yeah, hello. Jax is making an appearance.
Hello, Jax. It's weird because of course this and one of the other songs, Springsteen one, for some reason I remembered them as being longer. And this one is really short. And so,
well, yeah. It is just a TV theme song. They probably didn't record like a full, you know, radio edit version that's 3 minutes long or something.
Yeah, I think they didn't bother with it. And then I was looking at one of the other TV theme songs and it comes in at like 20 seconds or, and I went, okay, I can't do anything with this one. So this one, it was, since it's so short, and I already had an idea from before, just kind of fell out of my head as, oh, okay, let's do, instead of Love Boat, we'll do Like Ship. And it'll be about a guy who can't get a date and, you know, because women keep turning him down. I thought about the video and I went, I should just post, you know, pictures of guys from Tinder or, you know, one of the, and then I thought about that further and went, nah, I'm going to do dogs. I'm going to do dogs in sailor suits. So that's where the video came from. And my favorite was Vicky in the lineup, because they're like, the captain, the bartender, the cruise director. Vicky? What's a Vicky?
Jax is very confused by your appearance on my monitor because he was sniffing you really close, and then say hi.
It's the nose cam. He's confused by it.
He is probably.
he thinks I'm at his level.
He's not confused by seeing me on the monitor when it cuts back to me. I don't know why, but strange.
So yeah, that's the gist of it. The first version I did of this song was probably like 30 years ago when I was still playing Dungeons and Dragons and tabletop games.
Yeah.
And we had one that was space-based. I think it was actually called Space Opera. And we had some pirate ship that one of the characters was running, and he's like, I'm going to go take on that cruise ship. And what he didn't realize is that cruise liners put a lot of money into their cruise ships in space. So it has like super heavy shielding and a battery of guns. And so he's going at it and it's blowing him out of the water. And so I had one called the Blood Boat for him. Soon we'll be making another run.
That's great.
Yeah.
So you posted this song and then Gavin McLeod died.
Yeah, bizarre, huh? And yeah. And I had completely forgotten that it was him that was on the Mary Tyler Moore Show, and I loved him on that. He was great.
I never watched that show. I've seen a couple of episodes, but I never really watched it much. But I did watch, I don't know why I watched The Love Boat as a kid, just I did occasionally.
Yeah.
Oh, I knew him from that.
Yeah, I did like that, and Mary Tyler Moore, and then the Carol Burnett Show.
I love Carol Burnett Show. Yeah,
yeah, yeah, wild stuff. But yeah, Gavin McLeod. I guess He had a really good career, but it was not that varied. He actually did. He did an interview about the Love Boat, which I found fascinating. He's like, the critics hate it, but the audience loves it, and guest stars love to appear on it. It went on for 10 years.
Yeah,
it went a 10-year show. That's astounding.
Yeah, that's great. It's funny. A lot of actors from that era are typecast as to, like, you know, the one character you know them from. You know, the cast of Gilligan's Island famously talked about that, and
yeah,
it's like that doesn't seem to be happening quite so much anymore. You know, people, you know, they're known for one thing and then they go on to do other things. And it's like, okay, fine. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. There isn't the guy who's Superman or the guy who's Iron Man. It's, well, I mean, Robert Downey Jr. is Iron Man, but
yeah,
he's a lot of other things.
He won't be for, I mean, he's not anymore. And yeah. I think there's going to be a new Iron Man, because there were in the comics, there were other Iron Man other than Tony Stark, from what I believe. I've never read comics. I don't know, but I from what I've heard, there were other Iron Men. So,
yeah.
But yeah, like David Tennant, who played Doctor Who, you know, who played the Doctor, has gone on to do multiple other things, and
yeah,
very anti-Doctor characters too. You know,
he was a good villain in what was a Netflix
that other Marvel show, Jessica Jones.
Yeah, he was a great villain.
He was great in that. Yeah, and it was completely opposite the Doctor of character. You know, it was great.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I guess in the comic book, he was also supposed to be blue or purple. The character was supposed to be,
but
they didn't do that on Netflix. And I'm like, I don't know. It didn't really subtract anything for me.
Yeah, probably a budgetary thing. It's like, yeah, we can't afford the purple makeup this time. Sorry.
We'll do it in post.
Yeah. Just give everything a purple cast and, you know, color effect.
Yeah.
All right. So do you have anything you'd like to plug?
I will become president of the United States on July 8th.
Okay.
I'm in Netflix has Resident Evil Infinite Darkness coming out. And I played the president of the United States, President Graham.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Is this an animated show?
Yeah, it's like a mini series, I think. I haven't actually, the only thing I've seen is the same trailer that everybody else has seen, but
yeah. This is the first I'm hearing of it, and this sounds like it's right up my alley. I should be aware of this, and I'm not.
They're doing like the attack on Washington, and they get the president, and it's like, oh, okay. So it's got a lot of fan favorite characters and people brought back in specific roles. So they brought me in, and I'm like, oh, cool, I get to be the president in a Resident Evil thing. I haven't done any of those yet.
That's awesome. Yeah, look forward to that. It'd be nice to see something whose voice I recognize who isn't Chris, you know?
Yeah. And what else? I'm currently working on a song which has not been submitted yet, but it's actually got a triple entendre, if that's possible. Sure. It has like a wholesome thing to eat, implied cannibalism, and sexual overtones.
Nice.
So look forward to that coming out.
I am. All right. Well, thank you for joining us.
My pleasure.
Forward to your triple entendres.
Yes.
Bye.
Making the internet absolutely ridiculous. Dementia Radio.
www.dementiaradio.org. Port 8027.
Please hang up and try again.
This is the part where there's feedback.
Feedback.
Feedback. You know that segment of the show we do about now?
Feedback. Feedback.
Feedback.
Feedback. Wacky Ben wrote, Steve talking about his parents not familiar with the Beatles is like my grandma who either forgot about or was not aware of Willie Nelson. Because my brother once went to a music festival where Willie Nelson was performing, and my grandma asks, what's a Willie Nelson? True story. Thank you, Ben. And that's all the feedback we got for this week. So,
my favorite,
teasing. He's a teasing kind of guy. Now you have a joke.
Yeah.
Sorry, the lag is rough this week.
It's okay.
What were you going to say?
I was going to say my favorite triple entendre or triple pun that I've ever heard, probably the only one I can remember really, is Ukulamok's album Less Than Art. The first track on the album is about Commander Riker not being able to find the bathroom on the Enterprise.
Right.
And the song is called Number One.
Right.
Because Commander Riker, he has to pee, and it's the first track on the album. Number One.
Yep, I love that stuff. All right, teasing. Tomorrow's song is by a new artist.
What?
And we're going to have a special Sunday bonus slot this week by Steve Goody, now performing at FuMPCast. And Tuesday's song is by Lauren Mayer.
Yay, Lauren Mayer, woo!
And next week's Spotify playlist topic is Marvel, as in the various superheroes and whatnot. All right. Il Neige can be found on YouTube. Joe J. Thomas is at joesdump.com. Luke, you got anything to plug?
Well, I'll just say Il Neige is spelled I-L and then N-E-I-G-E. And that's it's on Twitter, he's Il Neige, YouTube, and on, on TikTok, he's all as one word, Il Neige, YouTube. And I think the Twitter version has, like, some underscores in there somewhere, I think. Anyway, I was going to say something else, but I can't remember what it was, but I do want to say something to you after the show ends. So,
okay.
Go.
Let's get out of here. Thank you for listening to the Funny Music Podcast. I'm Devo Spice.
I'm Lipsky!
Yeah.
Word. Thank you for listening to the Funny Music Podcast. You can listen live every Thursday night at 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 Pacific, at DementiaRadio.org, and join us in the chat, or subscribe to the podcast feed. Look us up on iTunes, and be sure to leave us a review. Feedback for the show can be sent to info@thefump.com. The Funny Music Podcast is a production of Fidem Interactive, LLC, released under a Creative Commons share-alike license. Tell your friends. Tell your enemies. Shout it to random people on the street. And be sure to visit thefump.com for the latest funny songs. Tune in next week, where you'll hear Luke Ski say...
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, sheetrock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, sheetrock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, sheetrock. We're going to Lowe's around the clock tonight. Yes, we'll deliver stuff when you're not around, and you won't hear it because it don't make sound. It's sheetrock of... Never mind.